Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hen Party by Josi Avari. Narrated by Angie Hickman. Chapter 1. Saffron hefted the chicken in her arms, trying to settle Tika's protests. Tika was not a car chicken. She did not enjoy car rides, and though the Empress insisted that a chicken could be trained to like civilized living, Saffron was not seeing much evidence of that with Tika. She carried the black and orange hen up the expansive steps of the Empress's estate house, juggling it in one arm and a package in the other. In the paper-wrapped package was a gift for the Empress, a large fish called a kumu. Saffron had bought it from Oka, the fisherman who showed up sometimes along the shoreline with his deep-bottom canoe filled with fish. Saffron was always happy to see him, as his fish were fresh and delicious. Today, she'd picked up some for herself and some to take to the Empress. The Empress's home was an old plantation house built into the side of the mountain behind the little Hawaiian town of Maikai, which Saffron had called home for several months now. She knocked and turned to take in the rugged palms that surrounded the estate, and beyond them, the gleam of the teal ocean striped with whitecaps. The colors of Hawaii dazzled Saffron. The rich greens and bright floral accents, the golden sun and sand, the crystalline blue water. All of it fed her in a way she'd never experienced. Saffron knew color differently than other people did. Color was a special experience for her. She seemed to see color more intensely and to see more colors than anyone else. When she looked at a red hibiscus blossom, for example, it was not just red. It was red with soft yellow hues, with the palest of blue cast over the curved surface of each petal. She had stopped trying to explain this to people, since to them a red flower was a red flower. Today, the pale pink of the plantation house was shaded with yellow reflections from the brilliant sunlight, making it a cheery peach color. The subtlety was not something Saffron often thought of, but occasionally, when something stood out, she wondered about the strange ability. She also had a perfect memory for color. In her mind was an extensive catalog of every color she'd ever seen, and the information her eyes sent her brain was constantly being cross-checked against this catalog. For example, the bronze sheen on the doorknob was exactly the color of the drawer pulls on the oak cabinets in the shabby Washington, D.C. apartment where she'd grown up, and the perfect match to the arms of a park bench in the U.S. National Arboretum. She toyed with the shade in her mind as the door swung open. Carlo, one of the two strong middle-aged men employed by the Empress, opened the door, invited her in, and took the fish to the kitchen. Coming here always felt like going back in time. The interior was decorated with lavish wood antiques from Europe, gilded mirrors and Renaissance paintings. It smelled cool and dusty, and the crystal chandeliers were kept dim. Carlo returned to show Saffron through the vast entry and back into the drawing room. The Empress sat, as always, at the window, gazing out at the immaculate garden and stroking Princess, her pet chicken. The Empress carried her everywhere on special pillows or lap quilts. Princess was a silky, a breed of chicken known for its soft, fluffy feathers, blue earlobes, and devotion to its owners. The third trait was evident now, as the little bird's eyelids drooped in contentment at the Empress's attentions. "Saffron!" the Empress exclaimed, and Princess jumped at the sound of her voice. Rex, the assistant behind the Empress, moved without command to turn the Empress's chair around and wheeled her over to greet her guest. The Empress was a vast woman, colossal in friendliness as well as size. She enveloped the room with her genuine interest in and affection for all living things within it. Her warm skin was the color of sable orchids, and the silver hair piled atop her head was secured with carved koa wood combs. She spoke with the soft accent of her first language, Samoan, draped over each English word. Saffron smiled as the Empress exclaimed over Tika,
"What a beauty! What a regal beauty you are!"
Tika arched her neck in response, and Saffron could almost believe that she knew what the Empress was saying. The Empress waved a hand, and Carlo swept Princess from her lap and held the chicken. The Empress waved Saffron closer and gathered Tika out of her grasp. Tika was much larger than Princess, but the difference was slight on the Empress's ample lap. Saffron tensed. Tika generally spent her days out in the pen with the other hens, laying an egg nearly every day, scratching for bugs, and bathing in the sand. She was not a house chicken like Princess. Saffron wasn't entirely sure what Tika would do. One look at the vases, rugs, and delicate carvings surrounding them brought an image of Tika flapping and scratching her way around the pristine drawing room. But the Empress's warm personality seemed to have the same effect on chickens as it did on people. As she stroked Tika's head, the chicken stilled, then settled, laying down with her soft underfeathers spread around her like a skirt. She gazed placidly over at Saffron, who breathed a sigh of relief.
"This is a very special chicken," the Empress gushed.
Saffron shrugged. She thought so too, as Tika had been her first friend when she'd moved here and taken over her late uncle's egg farm last fall. But she wasn't quite as demonstrative about her sentiments. The Empress went on.
"She is a Wyandotte. Gold-laced, see?"
She indicated Tika's brassy feathers, each outlined in a sharp black point.
"They are very docile generally, and make wonderful mothers."
Here, the Empress's eyes flicked up to the clock and rested a moment on a silver frame on the marble mantel over the fireplace. She turned to Rex.
"Check the window, will you? He should be here any time."
Saffron raised her eyebrows in an unspoken question.
"Oh, my dear. When I asked you over, I didn't know that my boy, my Davis, was coming to visit me today. He's in the Navy, you know, and I don't always know when he is near his home port. But he is coming, and I can't wait to see him. I didn't call off our playdate because Princess is so looking forward to spending time with Tika, and because, who knows, you and my Davis may find something in common."
Saffron tried not to smile. So that was it. Since she'd moved here, everyone in town who had an eligible bachelor relative from 21 to 50 had been subtly and not subtly trying to set her up. She didn't mind, but she had been spending a lot of time with her favorite bachelor, Keahi Kakoa, lately, and he might mind her being set up with someone else. Rex came back into the room and shook his head.
"No one yet, ma'am."
The Empress waved a dismissive hand.
"Thank you, Rex. Never mind."
To Saffron, she said,
"Oh, but that's not really why you're here. Let's go out to the garden so the children can play."
Again, Rex moved without instruction to wheel her toward the tall glass doors, and Carlo, cradling Princess in one arm, threw them open to let her pass. Outside, Carlo put Princess down in the chicken garden, a sunny spot where Saffron had seen her play before. It had been planted with chicken-friendly shrubs and sported a feeder, a small pond, and a nice sandy stretch for dirt bathing. Princess immediately set to work pecking at bugs in the grass below her. The Empress waved to Rex, and he gathered Tika and set her down on the lawn next to Princess. Again, Saffron tensed. She had seen displays of dominance in her flock at home, and she'd tried to talk the Empress out of the idea of this hen party. But the Empress had insisted that Princess was lonely for her kind and must have a visitor. Saffron had chosen Tika to bring along because she was the most docile of the flock at Haʻolikomoa Egg Farm, and because she had recently raised several chicks, so she was more tolerant than many of the other hens. Princess went immediately to the newcomer, watching her with one eye. Tika didn't seem to notice the little ball of fluff. Saffron could only assume that because of the silky strange appearance, Tika didn't realize Princess was another chicken, and so didn't feel threatened by her. Princess mimicked Tika's movements and followed her around contentedly as they both searched for bugs and pecked at seeds on the bushes nearby. The Empress watched for a while, a look of pure satisfaction on her face.
"This is what she has been needing," They are flock animals, you know.
Saffron nodded.
Humans need each other, the Empress stated, and so do other creatures.
I think you may be right, Saffron said, watching the birds as they dipped their beaks and raised their heads, drinking from the pond. She had struggled with loneliness herself back in Washington, D.C., before she came here. Since arriving on the islands, she had learned to value friends. In the still of the moment, a loud call broke the heavy Hawaiian spring air. It was half battle cry, half victory whoop, and it made the Empress's head swivel and her hands flutter. Rex and Carlos scrambled to spin her around, just as a handsome sailor strode out of the house.
Mama!
His resonant voice filled the backyard, and he crossed the garden in three steps to throw himself to his knees beside the Empress's wheelchair. He wrapped his arms around her, and Saffron looked away as the Empress buried her face in his short black hair, tears streaming down her cheeks.
6 months is too long for me to not see you, she said,
her voice soft with tenderness.
Too long for me too,
he smiled. The Empress seemed to suddenly remember Saffron.
Oh, my Davis, she said as he stood. I have got a girl for you to meet. This is Saffron. She's come all the way from Washington, D.C. to take over Beau's old egg farm.
Davis smiled, a grin full of warmth and humor. Saffron saw in his eyes that his mother had also set him up plenty of times.
Nice to meet you, he said. Mama sent me lots of interesting tidbits about you while I was at sea.
Saffron felt her cheeks flush. Davis smiled and turned back to his mother.
Guess what?
What?
The Empress's tone was light and playful.
I've got a girl for you to meet.
Saffron felt a rush of both relief and disappointment. Davis turned toward the house, and Saffron looked up to see a willowy girl with light brown hair drifting out the doors like a petal on the wind.
My fiancé.
Davis's impossibly wide grin grew even more expansive. The girl slipped up to him and settled into the curve of his uniformed arm. The Empress squealed like she was on a roller coaster.
What? My baby's getting married? When? How? Why haven't I heard of this lovely girl? What's her name? Davis, introduce me to my new daughter-in-law this instant.
Saffron squirmed. A confirmed neat freak, she did not like for things to be out of place, and that's exactly what she was now. This was an intimate moment between the Empress and her son, and Saffron felt conspicuous and awkward being there. She glanced at Carlo and Rex, both of whom stood calm and detached. They seemed more a part of the garden than part of the event. Two stately topiaries whose only movement was the flick of an eye in the general direction of the now-forgotten chickens. Saffron was glad to have the chickens to direct her attention to, as she heard Davis say,
Mama, this is Liza Corelli. Where in the world did you meet her? Was it in a port of call? Did you see each other across a crowded marketplace?
The Empress had an affinity for exotic historical romance novels, and it was showing now. No, nothing so exciting as that, Liza said, her voice soft and musical. Saffron couldn't help but glance back at the striking couple.
We met through my bunkmate, Logan Prentice. He's another seaman from Liza's hometown. She was vacationing in Spain when we came into port at Rota. She came to visit him in port, and she and I hit it off. Logan was on duty, so I took her to dinner.
The rest is history, Liza chimed in.
And last night, when we came into port, she met me here, and I asked her to marry me.
Davis's face was shining, his eyes dancing with the news. That's what it looks like to be in love, Saffron thought. Watching them together, she felt a stab of jealousy for the first time in a long time.
Well, this is just the most exciting news,
the Empress beckoned the couple closer.
When's the big day?
Davis laughed.
We haven't decided yet, but you'll be the first to know. I just wanted to bring her here to introduce her to you and to show her where I grew up.
Ah, the Empress said. You're going to love it here, and my grandchildren will be close to me.
She gazed lovingly at Davis and Liza. Saffron noticed that it was their turn to squirm. No wonder. They had just gotten engaged and now there was talk of grandchildren. The Empress looked suddenly upset.
But you don't take her to the diving rock.
Davis waved her away.
Ah, Mama, the accident was 25 years ago, and I can swim now. I'm a sailor.
Liza's blue eyes were wide. What happened?
I was 7, a little too brave for my own good. We used to hike from the beach up to the top of this cliff and look down on the diving rock in the bay. We were up there, and I saw people jumping off the diving rock, so I decided I needed to do it too. Us boys went back down, and as soon as we got there, I climbed the diving rock like the teenagers were doing and threw myself off. Of course, I didn't know how to hit the water, and I belly flopped. Got the air knocked out of me, that's all.
The Empress's eyes were closed.
He sunk like a stone. I couldn't get to him. I was screaming and screaming for someone to get him out of the water.
When I could kick, I pulled in a big lungful of water.
He was shaking his head.
If Uncle Minot hadn't been there, I would have drowned. He dived right in and hauled me up, pumped the water out of me on the beach. Saved my life.
You know Minot? Saffron blurted. The three of them looked at her as if they just remembered she was there.
Oh yeah, his grandson and I hung around a lot.
Keahi?
Saffron still couldn't say the name without smiling. That's right. You've met him?
Davis shook his head.
Of course, I forgot he was back around here.
Speaking to Liza, he said,
You'll have to meet him. He's a great guy.
And his grandfather saved your life. I'll have to thank him for that. Liza gave Davis a squeeze and smiled up at him.
That was a terrible day, the Empress said. Terrible. I still have nightmares about it.
A little shiver ran through her voice on the word nightmares. Davis reached for his mother's hand.
Mama, I told you. I can swim now. I'm on the water all the time.
The Empress's hand trembled as she gripped her son's.
That's not the problem, Atali'i. You mustn't go to the bay because the Minos have returned.
Her voice was low. Your friend's grandfather? Liza asked.
No, though that is his name too,
the Empress said patiently.
Minos are sharks.
Sharks? Liza's blue eyes were bright with alarm.
She's from Massachusetts, Davis said, as if this explained her reaction. Don't worry, baby. They're just coming in to feed and mate.
Ch, the Empress chided Davis.
You simplify. These are not just sea animals doing animal things. They are Aumakua, and they have gathered for a purpose. They sent something. They have not been to Maikai'i altogether like this for many years,
the Empress said.
Of course, they individually have visited their families, but not as a group. The researchers, they say that the Minos have not been gathering because of currents or tourists or because there is not enough food. But we know. They have not all been needed at once, but they are needed now. Something is coming, and they need to protect their families from it.
Saffron had not been in Hawaii long, but the time she had spent with Keahi and his grandfather had taught her that there were deep traditions here that she respected and was continually trying to better understand. Liza blinked rapidly, tipping her head up at Davis in a question. Saffron could see a struggle in him, between, she supposed, his traditions and his modern life, his mother and his fiancée. Finally, he closed his eyes and nodded.
Many families here have deities in the form of animals that watch over them and protect their families.
The Empress smiled warmly as she explained further.
These are our ancestors. Their spirits return in the form of these animals to warn us or protect us. Some families have ancestors that appear as honu, sea turtles. Others have geckos, or eels, or birds like the pueo, the owl.
The Empress's words were reverent.
We know our own aumakua, and we take care of them.
Oh,
was all Liza said. Saffron thought she could be more enthusiastic.
It was a powerful and beautiful belief.
Davis went on. For many families, their aumakua is a shark, and there is a legend.
An account,
the Empress corrected crisply, and she went on from there.
Of a gathering of aumakua, sharks that came to the beach at the diving rock and waited. Their families knew them, and they went and fed them. And when a huge jellyfish bloom came, the sharks stood guard and turned the tides and fed on the jellyfish to keep them away from the beach, and no one here was stung. The towns around Maikai suffered, but no one in Maikai was hurt, because the aumakua protected their families.
There was a long pause, and Liza cleared her throat.
That's amazing, she managed.
And now they have returned, and they have work to do,
the Empress chided.
So don't bother them at the diving rock. And if it keeps me away from there, then the aumakua are doing you a favor too, huh, Mama?
Davis was teasing, but there was a gentle reverence in his voice.
I give them an offering now and again, the Empress returned. And they've kept you safe at sea, haven't they?
Davis looked closely at his mother. Hey, speaking of offerings to the sharks, where is Princess?
The Empress's hands flew to her lap in a burst of momentary panic before she spied the two hens curled together, resting in the shade of an oleander bush.
We're having a little hen party, aren't we, Manamea?
She used a Samoan term of endearment, a word that Saffron had gathered meant something like sweetheart. Princess looked up at her.
Come here then, and see your big brother.
She reached into a bag hanging from her wheelchair and extracted a small can, which she shook. The rattling made Princess leap to her feet and lumber over in an awkward canter to flap her way into the Empress's arms. Tika, disturbed from her nap, also stood, shook her feathers, and meandered over. The Empress rewarded each of them with a few golden treats of dried grains from the can. Saffron reached down and collected Tika.
I'd really better be on my way, she said, grateful that a smooth segue had presented itself. I've got customers coming for eggs soon.
The Empress bade her a cheerful goodbye, and Carlo saw her out. Saffron left the Empress and her guests cooing over Princess. Chapter 2. The next afternoon, Saffron was waiting under the monkey pod tree that stretched over the lanai when Keahi's steel gray SUV came rolling up the drive. She'd finished her egg deliveries and dealt with the Tuesday pickup customers that came each morning before their own work to pick up a dozen eggs for the week. She called it the egg line because they lined up their cars down the driveway and stopped at the yard, where Saffron handed them eggs through the windows of the vehicles. Keahi swung out of the car with the natural grace that always surprised her. He was a head taller than her, with powerful arms and a quick smile. He'd been a surgeon on the mainland until he lost a 6-year-old patient and came back home. Saffron didn't know the whole story, but she knew him well enough to know the trauma of the loss was still fresh. Now he worked at the Laki Luau, performing dances and songs from his native Hawaiian culture. Keahi pulled her into his arms for a hello kiss. She laced her fingers through the cropped curls on the back of his head. Keahi laid his cheek alongside hers and inhaled, which Saffron had learned from his grandpa, her friend Mano, was an intimate greeting. She inhaled too, and the warm scent of koa wood and orange filled her mind. Keahi's kisses were not frequent, so Saffron lingered as long as she could in the moment. What are we doing today? She asked as he stepped back and walked to the car.
I've got a special place to show you.
It was a 15-minute drive before Keahi pulled the SUV off the highway, stopping in front of an ornate iron gate. He hopped out and punched a code into the keypad on the gate. Then they drove up a driveway with foliage so dense that Saffron didn't see the house until they were upon it. It was magnificent. A wood-sided two-story perched out on a jutting black cliff. Keahi led her inside, where they were greeted by Mano.
You kids have come to appreciate my work, he said,
waving a hand at the ornately carved cabinets he had just finished polishing. Mano was a master carver.
The people who own this house have hired Tutu.
Keahi used the Hawaiian word as he referred to his grandfather.
To do all the woodwork. And it's all complete, finally, Mano said, waving a hand.
Saffron walked through the house, studying his intricate carvings on the doors, the window frames, the broad, curving banister that led up to the second floor balcony over the great room. It was the great room that took her breath away. Glass walls offered an unimpeded view of the panoramic ocean and the hazy islands in the distance. On either side of the room, the cliff fell away so sharply that you couldn't see the black rock that supported the house. It gave the effect of the house floating in midair 50 feet above the blue water. This place is spectacular, she said. Who owns it? It was tastefully furnished but lacked any personal touches. Family photos, knickknacks, or the general clutter of living, like unopened mail or empty grocery bags.
Keahi's friend from medical school, Mano said.
Keahi held up a hand.
Not exactly my friend, he said, shaking his head. He was the chief of vascular surgery at one of the hospitals where I interned. He's retired, and he bought this land, then had the house built. He had all the work inside done by local craftsmen. Mostly by me,
Mano laughed. Saffron loved hearing the musical sound of it. The old man had lost his best friend when she first got here, and it was good to see him happy again.
Hiwalani,
he addressed his grandson. Saffron had learned that the phrase meant beloved or favorite child, and she liked hearing Mano say it.
I need to borrow your car while you picnic. I have several more final pieces to bring and install this afternoon. Then the place will be finished. Sure.
Keahi handed him the keys, and Mano left them alone. He'd been scheming to get them together ever since Saffron met him in the hardware store, and he wasn't letting up. Keahi smiled at her. They both knew Mano's ulterior motives, and she thought it a good sign that neither of them minded the old man's matchmaking. Keahi took her hand.
If you think the view's great from in here, you should see outside.
Together they left the house and walked through the brisk breeze onto a wide side yard set back from the tip of the point. There, Keahi had spread a picnic blanket. She saw one of the Oceanside Cafe's famous beachy baskets, packed meals that patrons could pick up and take along for outdoor dining. All they had to do was return the basket. Saffron tried to imagine what was inside, but when Keahi opened it and pulled out the contents, she was still surprised. A full tray of glazed shrimp lined up on skewers brought a tantalizing sweet and savory scent. Keahi lifted out a bowl of coconut sticky rice next, and a mango, pineapple, strawberry, guava, and kiwi salad was last. Saffron had eaten it at the Oceanside Cafe before. The honey ginger poppy seed dressing set off the fruit flavors perfectly. She waited impatiently as Keahi piled two paper plates high with the bounty. Saffron pulled a shrimp off its bamboo skewer with her teeth, wondering if she'd ever felt so content as she did now. The light wind tossed her strawberry hair across her field of vision, and she tucked it back behind her ear. Somewhere below the lip of the cliff, she could hear seabirds crying. Occasionally, one would peek in its flight just a foot or two above the edge of the cliff. They always seemed surprised to see Saffron and Keahi casually lunching at such a great height. The unusual thing about the Hawaiian shoreline, Saffron had found, was how varied it was. In some places, like her farm, the golden sand ran in a gentle slope up to the stubbly grasses where the house sat. Here, The sea had worn away all traces of sand and left only these rocky cliffs and a steep plunge down to the water. The breeze picked up and lifted Saffron's napkin from her lap, sending it scudding just a few feet away on the lawn. Both she and Kiahi jumped up to grab it, and both chased it a dozen feet before pulling back as it sailed on a wind current up and over the edge.
"I think we'll let it go," she said.
She stepped back from the cliff.
"We should," he said. "But you should still take a look over the edge. It's beautiful."
Saffron's heart pounded.
"That's okay."
"Listen, I've been coming up here my whole life. Over there,"
Keahi pointed across the lawn to where the dense trees and bushes began,
"is a path that goes all the way down to the beach by the diving rock. My friends and I used to climb up here and let the wind blow in our hair and watch people jump off the diving rock. None of us ever fell, and we were careless 13-year-old boys. You'll be all right."
Saffron shook her head. The only experience she'd had with heights was from inside elevators. Even then, she wasn't crazy about the thought of how far away the ground was. Keahi must have recognized her discomfort.
"It's okay. I'll hold you."
He took her hand. She wanted to show him she could do it, and she wanted to keep holding his hand. She edged forward. He was right. Looking down into the crystalline water below, she could barely breathe. It was like flying with the whole ocean stretched out below you. Keahi slid his arms around her, and she leaned back into his strong presence, but she didn't take her eyes off the water. Directly below them was a deep bay where the cliff fell off into the sea. Slightly to the right, about halfway down the cliff, was a conspicuous jutting rock, and beyond it, on the far right of Saffron's view, was a beach that ran off casually around the next gentle curve of the island.
"Want to go diving?"
Keahi said.
"Diving? From here? No."
He laughed.
"From the diving rock down there. It has a perfect trail up and a great little drop."
"This is enough of a thrill for me," Saffron said, sure she could never willingly jump into the sea. The bird set up a noisy protest. They wheeled high in the air and swept up above Saffron and Keahi's heads, winging away toward the mountains behind them. Saffron looked down at the clear water again and grasped at Keahi's arms, tightening them around her.
"Keahi, look!"
The azure water below them was alive with dark shadows, perfect silhouettes of enormous sharks. They glided, weaving together and around each other, turning as one and sliding under the water, back around the dark shape of the diving rock together until the last one had disappeared. Saffron and Keahi watched in stunned silence until the group returned and repeated their maneuver. Keahi's arms had tensed. Saffron turned to look at him.
"How many do you think there were?"
20 or more," he said,
his voice filled with awe. "A group of sharks is called a frenzy," Saffron said, the fact skimming through her mind like the shapes of the big animals below.
Keahi replied.
"What kind are they?"
"I can't tell for sure, but I think tigers."
"Tiger sharks."
Saffron felt a chill run up her spine. She'd watched for sharks ever since coming to Hawaii, but these were the first she'd actually seen. Their graceful shapes in the water mesmerized her. The sharks came back around the point of the rock, patrolling the bay. They didn't all swim in the same direction. Some looped back past and under or over the others, but as a body, they moved together. She thought about what the Empress had said, that the sharks were gathering to protect against some unseen threat. The way they moved, Saffron could almost believe that's what they were doing. Watching them made her understand power and majesty in a whole new way.
"I need to make a phone call,"
Keahi said, stepping back from the cliff's edge. Saffron heard him over her shoulder, talking to Mano on the phone, telling him about the tiger sharks in the bay. His voice was low, and Saffron could tell that there was significance in the gathering of the sharks. She wondered if Keahi's family had a shark aumakua. She let herself consider for a moment that one of those powerful creatures may be an ancestor of Keahi's. She jumped as her own phone rang. It was the Empress. Saffron braced for another playdate invitation, but that wasn't what the call was about.
"My Davis has decided to get married this weekend."
The Empress's voice shook with excitement. "This weekend?" Today was Tuesday.
"Yes, right here in Maikai so that his mother can be there." Liza was just insistent that she didn't need anything big. She just wanted to do it now. They've already called friends and family, and I've talked to the Kahu about marrying them. But we need you to put together the party.
Saffron tried to find words. In 4 days?
I heard all about your magical open house when you were going to sell Haolikomoa. I know you can do it.
I don't know. I haven't planned anything here, really. I haven't got any contacts.
Well, it's time you start making some. I'll send you some names.
Saffron tried to breathe. 4 days?
4 days,
the Empress said.
I know that's a rush, so we'll pay extra for the extra work.
She named a figure. Saffron gulped. That was more money than she'd made on 3 weddings back in D.C. She took the job. Keahi was standing at her elbow when she hung up.
Planning a wedding?
He asked, smiling. Saffron nodded numbly. In 4 days.
This Saturday?
This Saturday.
Wow. Where at?
I don't know, Saffron snapped. I still have to plan the whole thing.
Okay.
Keahi's voice was even. He was good at being calm when Saffron was feeling tense. Where am I even going to hold it? At the Oceanside Cafe? Saffron paced. This would be her first paid event in Maikai, and it was for the Empress. She wanted it to be wonderful. No, it needs to be grand and impressive. Keahi laid a hand on her arm, and she stopped pacing.
How about here?
He said, waving his other arm wide.
This is pretty grand and impressive.
Saffron pressed her lips together, picturing the Kahu, the Hawaiian pastor, along with the bride and groom, standing in front of those glorious windows in the house. That could work, she said slowly.
Do you want me to check with Dr. Evans? I'm sure he wouldn't mind. He says he'd like it to be useful to the community. They designed it to withstand storms so people could shelter here. He gave the codes to the local police and emergency people. And he said they'd even like to have parties out here.
Saffron began to imagine it. Would you check with him? She asked tentatively. Keahi pulled out his phone. Dr. Evans was apparently a jovial person, because there was a lot of laughter and promises to get together. Saffron was relatively sure that the answer was yes, and by the time Keahi hung up, she was already envisioning a navy and mustard color scheme.
He says go ahead, Keahi smiled. And he said you can have it all weekend, in case you want to do a rehearsal dinner or reception or anything in addition to the ceremony.
Saffron stopped, took a deep breath, and smiled at him. Thanks. Keahi was always good at finding solutions. Another voice answered from behind her.
Thanks for what?
Mano was walking across the lawn toward them. Keahi didn't answer him, just stepped forward to intercept him and led him quickly to the cliff's edge, where they stood talking in low, earnest tones for a long time. When they turned back to Saffron, Mano's eyes were joyful.
My namesake is in town, he said. Come on, kids.
Together, they piled into the SUV and started off. 10 minutes later, they were pulling off the road in front of a ragged little house just steps from the beach. Minot waved the two after him, and they went in without knocking. It was dim inside. There were various types of art everywhere. Woven wall hangings, carvings, tikis, and paintings. She looked a long moment at a short wooden oar carved with just the kind of shark she'd seen from the cliff.
"Who lives here?" Saffron asked,
her eyes running over the artifacts.
"Uncle Lakoni,"
Kiahi answered.
"He has a lot of things,"
Saffron said, not quite sure what word to use.
"He's a kahuna,"
Kiahi said. Then, as he was getting very good at doing, defined,
"Sort of a spiritual guide and teacher. He's also a great friend of my grandfather's."
Minot called out as they entered.
"Hey, Okoni, how's it?"
A shout came from the back of the house, and they walked through the living room and the kitchen, out onto a small lanai where an old man was gutting an enormous fish. Minot waved Saffron and Kiahi on past them, and they stepped off the lanai onto the amber sand of the beach. Saffron could see where the water came, at high tide, nearly to the worn boards. Now the waves lapped 10 feet away, across the beautiful sand. Okoni's house was not isolated. It was one of many little old beach houses in various states of repair, in a line along the shore. Saffron heard the men talking, though she was trying not to listen. They were talking about the sharks.
"We need to find out what brought them here. They must sense something is coming."
"That bad luck boy is back in town," Okoni said. "Maybe he's the reason."
"Davis had bad luck, brother. He didn't bring it."
"You say?"
"I do."
"It wasn't until we got rid of him to the Navy that things started turning around here. We get rid of him again, maybe the Almakua are satisfied."
They were talking about Davis. Saffron wondered what made Okoni say that he was bad luck. Kiahi was ahead of her, at the edge of the water, looking out over the vast reef. He was reliable and handsome, solid and dependable, and Saffron couldn't help but want to be near him. Just as she reached his side, though, Minot called to them. Saffron turned to see him holding a huge chunk of the fish Okoni had been working on. Minot jerked his head toward the house, and Saffron could see a boat propped up against the worn siding. It was long and narrow, and had a support float jutting out from its side. Kiahi jogged up the beach and across the porch. Saffron followed, and he shot her a smile as she helped him lift the boat and carry it to the water. Minot and Okoni were waiting for them. They stepped up with big chunks of the raw fish and settled them into a square wooden chamber in the center of the canoe. It looked almost like a lidless cooler. On either side of it, toward each end, were two narrow boards that made up 4 seats in all. As soon as the canoe was set in the water, the old men climbed in the back and settled into the 2 rear seats. The boat seemed perilously unbalanced. Saffron stood watching.
"Come on,"
Okoni waved to her and Kiahi. Saffron eyed the canoe. It looked like it barely fit Minot and Okoni. She didn't see how it could float with 2 more people. But the men had obviously left the front for the 2 of them, and when Kiahi climbed in and stretched a hand toward her, she followed. She settled on the bench right in front of Kiahi, and he slid an arm around her waist and pulled her back against his chest as the canoe began to move out into the water, rowed by Okoni and Minot. Saffron saw the golden sand dropping away below them as they went farther from the shore. In some places, jagged coral jutted up near the water's surface, but Okoni and Minot seemed to know just where these hidden dangers lurked and avoided them expertly. Saffron gazed across the water, watching it stretch toward the horizon, an unbroken ribbon of blue.
"Is that a boat?"
Saffron pointed to a triangle of white bobbing far out in the water, and Kiahi put his cheek next to hers and looked where she was indicating.
"I think so," he said.
Minot answered too.
"That's right. It's Oke Cooper's canoe."
Saffron squinted and thought she could just make out the shape of the wiry man she'd bought the kumu fish from yesterday. She'd eaten hers last night, steamed with a little lemon, just like Kiahi had taught her.
She'd become quite the cook in her last few months here. She thought about Oka as she watched the sail of his boat bob up and down far on the horizon. Oka was not an old man, but he looked old. His face was heavily pocked, his hands and arms scarred from years of net fishing and working with his catch. He was thin and sun-worn, and rarely smiled. The most remarkable thing Saffron had learned about him was that he lived on his boat, night and day, sleeping in the hull at night and filling it with fish in the day. He sailed all around the island, fishing and selling his catch on the beaches. He showed up irregularly in Maikai, and people flocked to him when he did. Saffron liked being on the water, liked the sound of the waves lapping the canoe, liked the splash of the paddles behind them. Impulsively, she turned her head and kissed Keahi on the jaw. He looked down into her eyes and kissed her back quickly.
"Hey," Okoni barked, "get to work up there."
Minot chuckled.
"They are just getting close to centralize the weight, brah. It's good for balance."
Okoni made a grunt, and Keahi smiled as he let her go and picked up a paddle. Saffron felt the speed of the canoe increase as Keahi put his powerful arms to the task of slicing through the waves. She could hear the old men talking behind them, laughing at having a young man aboard. At one point, she looked back, and they were both leaning back with their sandaled feet on the edge of the boat and their hands clasped behind their heads, making a jovial picture of relaxation.
"We're just like the tourists. Strong brother rowing us out to see the sharks," Minot said.
"Sharks?" Saffron curled involuntarily into the center of her seat. This did not look like the kind of vessel one took to see sharks. Desperately, she tried to think where they had driven. They had come down off the point and back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.